फ्रंट लोडेड, द इंटरेस्ट रेट्स, द डिस्काउंट रेट रेज टू 13.25% व्हेन द कोर इन्फ्लेशन वॉज 7%. फ्रैंकली आई हैव अ प्रॉब्लम बिकॉज डिस्काउंट रेट्स डोंट मैनेज फूड इन्फ्लेशन. कोर इन्फ्लेशन ऑफ 7% एंड ओवरऑल इन्फ्लेशन ऑफ लिल ओवर 10%, वेर द रेस्ट वॉज फूड इन्फ्लेशन. आई थिंक IMF मैंडेटिंग अस टू गो टू 13.25% वॉज एन ओवर किल विच कॉस्ट अस हंड्रेड्स ऑफ बिलियंस ऑफ रूपीज. दे ऑल्सो मेड अस डू अ स्टीप डिवैल्यूएशन ऑफ आर रूपी. There were sharp increases in electricity, gas, and other tariffs to bring down the circular debt flows. Well, this was for stabilization of the economy. Obviously, the growth rate, went down. And we're looking at around 1.5-1.9% growth, but then COVID happened. And COVID pushed this growth to negative territory, 0.5%. The government just did well, introduced a fiscal stimulus, gave people, the needy people, some money, cash, and it was very efficiently done by the ESSAS program. There was a liquidity stimulus by the State Bank of Pakistan for the business sector, whether large, small, and then Prime Minister, I think, did a great job by introducing the construction package, because he realized that construction is one industry which not only just brings in a lot of labor to work, but also supports around 40-42 industries on its own. And by giving them the incentives, he would at least pump up some kind of, economic activity. Economy started to stabilize, current account deficits, was curtailed. And in the recent year, it is in a surplus. But economic growth was negative. It started recovering this year as the large-scale manufacturing started to pick up, exports started to pick up, agriculture, major crops were, very robust, except cotton, and services sector, started to pick up alongside the housing. Not only this happened, but as the economy picked up, we have seen the revenues of the government also started to pick up. This month, they will cross 4 trillion rupees for the first time in the history of Pakistan, and probably will be closer to 4.2. We see a 3.94% growth in the economy. Well, people predicted start of this fiscal that will probably be between 1.5% to 3%, but I think we are hitting around 3.94%. But this is where we are today. So you want to hear what are we going to do going forward? I think what we want is an inclusive and sustainable growth over a long period of time. As Humayun said, the East Asian economies such as Turkey, they achieved a certain level of economic, prosperity through inclusive and sustainable growth. So, as he said that, we have never had sustainable growth for a long period of time except in the 60s. So when I just came in, I just got some eminent economists together. We had an EAC, Economic Advisory Council, but out of that advisory economic council, we had few eminent economists led by Dr. Ishwar Sen, and I requested them to find out why don't we have an inclusive and sustainable growth over a long period of time? What causes us to break the cycle? So they are working on it. By the next week, we'll probably have, you know, a very comprehensive answer. But then we also tasked these, you know, the Economic Advisory Council to work with the government in 12 sectors of the economy, and give us short-term, medium and long-term plans how to grow these sectors. We do not have the resources to, you know, cover all the sectors, but we are focused now. And I'm talking about major sectors like, you know, fiscal side, we're talking about, you know, the agriculture, manufacturing, you know, power sector, you know, financial sector, housing, you know, all those major sectors. We said, now you please give us some way forward. And this is the first time that we'll be doing this. Because after the 60s, when we used to have a very powerful planning commission, and it used to be mother of the government, I think successive governments, you know, made them just a project evaluation and implementation division. This time around, we are going to do this, and hopefully, when it starts working, we are going to fold that, you know, whole process into the planning commission to make it once again a very powerful, you know, ministry. But then we will have a planned growth and a roadmap which we can, not only this government can follow, but your subsequent governments can also follow. And this has been, you know, the hallmark of countries who have grown, that they had consistency in the planning process. And whether it's India, China, and some of the other East Asian countries, and even in Turkey. So, what is our focus now? I think our focus has now shifted to growth. Unless we do not grow the economy, I think with all these other things, you know, we are not going to be able to move into the next orbit. So how do we grow the economy? The first task is obviously, like any other government, is to increase revenues. Our revenues at less than 10% of GDP, they're not good enough. So we have to figure out how to grow these revenues, and I will tell you some of those things which we will be doing. But the fact is that we are going to add ₹1 trillion into our, you know, revenue stream, you know, next year. This year will be the highest, you know, revenue collection, closer to, you know, 4.8 trillion rupees, which is the first in history. But then next year we'll probably go to around 5.8 trillion. I'm just saying, you know, closer to, you know, 6 trillion. But whether it's 5.8 or 6, it's you know, pretty close. But never have we collected ₹1 trillion additionally in a year. So that receives our number one, you know, a kind of focus or efforts. Then PSDP, we are going to spend $650 billion this year. But then we'll ramp it up to around $900 billion next year. But it will have to be efficient. And I think for the knowledge of the audience, the Planning Commission started, you know, doing the public-private partnerships, you know, in the PSDP, which means the amount of $900 billion will have a greater impact on the ground with the participation of the private sector. Then we move into the productive sectors. Productive sectors of our economy, which are number one to me, is agriculture. We all know that we used to be a food exporting country. Now we are a net food importing country. This is a far cry from the 60s, 70s and even 80s, 90s. So we got to focus on that. We have to focus on all the elements of our agriculture chain. And I think there is the plan which is really a very, very progressive plan which is being put in place. And in this budget too, you will see that we'll put in law, give a lot of incentives to the agriculture, you know, sector of our economy. We have to make our industry more efficient. When we make our industry more efficient, our exports become more efficient and we export more. So, Hamayun asked, you know, why is it that we keep falling in this trap? The very fact is that when we start growing, obviously there is a pressure on, you know, imports. People have the buying power, so they just try to buy other things which are then we can't manufacture, we don't manufacture, so we import. And that puts pressure on our, reserves, foreign currency reserves. Because our exports are not keeping pace with our overall growth, we fall short of dollars. Never have we gone into a tailspin for other reason than balance of payments. So exports, exports, exports. I think that is the mantra. And I will later on tell you what kind of measures we are taking, you know, to just boost our exports. We are also going to just give incentives to our service industry, whether it's housing. We are also, within the services sector, we have also make, our e-commerce very efficient through digitization. And we will give incentives over there. So that we, rather than, you know, just being a cash economy, it becomes a digital economy. And that creates, you know, opportunities for us, even in the revenue collection. We have to stabilize the power sector. Power sector is a big hole. Today, at 2.3 trillion, you know, the circular debt is humongous. Not only we have to stop the flows, we got to reduce it over a period of time. And how do we do it? When there is a challenge of capacity payments, which are going to go up, rise up to 1.45 trillion rupees a year. Remember I told you it was 465 billion in 2018. It's going to triple to 1.5 trillion, 4.5 trillion. Because I think when we started installing additional capacity, we forgot that it has to be used. Or otherwise, because of the contracts, we'll have to start paying for the electricity we are not even, you know, producing and using. So this is a great challenge, because unless we make it financially viable, nobody is going to invest in this sector in the future. So this is a great challenge, and we are coming up with innovative ways to make sure that our circular debt does not increase and starts reducing, you know, over a period of time. But the Prime Minister has given commitment to the people of Pakistan that, you know, we are not going to increase the electricity tariff in the near future, because that doesn't help. People are already burdened with, you know, a very costly electricity. Maybe the lower end is protected, but what about the middle class? What about the industrial sector, commercial sector, export sector? So, power sector has to be stabilized. We need to control prices. And prices here, you know, what we see is all food inflation. I've already mentioned to you about agriculture. Unless we do not increase the production of agriculture, this is not going to be, you know, controlled in a kind of a long term. So we also have to give the market the mechanism to take away these large margins which people have, the middlemen have, from the farmer to the wholesaler. The margins are over 400-500%. So we need to create commodity warehousing, cold storages, mechanism for farmer to come to the wholesale market themselves, alongside, you know, productivity in the agriculture sector, so that we start producing surpluses. Administrative control also will have to be strengthened. And during the Musharraf era, I think price magistrate, control magistrates were removed. We have to think through, you know, whether we have to bring them back. But importantly, I think, you know, this is going to be a change from the previous governments, that we are not only going to be dependent on the trickle-down effect to boost the incomes of the people. Because what has happened in the past is that with 3-5 year, you know, growth cycles, the minute, you know, the trickle-down reaches in the bottom segments of our society, the cycle breaks. So these guys, they take one step forward and then fall right back to where they were. So that is why we are saying a sustainable growth over a long period of time, so that they basically, that trickle-down effect reaches all sectors of the economy. But as I said, departure from the past, we are also going to be working on the bottoms-up approach. Even Joe Biden has said the U.S. needs that. If U.S. needs that, by God, we certainly need that. When I say bottoms-up approach, I'm saying the 4 to 6 million households at the bottom rung of our income levels will have to be given interventions whereby they can earn their living on their own and not just be dependent on handouts. They should have houses. They should have health insurance. They should have skill development for, you know, their family members, so that they can go and just, you know, get some jobs. A comprehensive package. And we have to do it in a way whereby it's not inflationary. That it basically does not, you know, we don't depend on fiscal deficits to fund this. So it has to be innovative, and we are working on that. So what do we have in the budget? I think in the budget, we have additionality of 1 trillion rupees in revenues. We are not going to increase taxes on people who are paying taxes. Apart from, we will remove some incentives from people we believe they have been given incentives for no rhyme or reason. We are going to take away the harassment, you know, of the FBR from the lives of the people. A lot of people complain that we are not in the net because we are worried about the harassment of FBR. So in this budget, you will see the announcement that there will be universal self-assessment and third-party audit for 3-4% of the population, a risk-based population, but done by third party. No FBR person will do that. So people will be free of the harassment of the FBR. But if that is done, then it will be incumbent upon people who have incomes or the merchants who have, you know, who basically control consumption, to to pay taxes. Because if we find out and we'll have a cell which go all out using technology, which now gives us the ability to reach out to those people who have electricity bills, they have energy bills, they have deposits. So we have the data. We'll reach them, and if they are willful defaulters, if those people who are supposed to pay taxes are not paying taxes, so we'll basically take punitive actions and put them behind bars. We mean business. We believe that using technology will help us expand our retail, GST. We have around 80,000 POSs in the market. We are only using 10,000 who are linked to the FBR. But I just want to go beyond that. I want to go beyond the 80,000. I want to take this POSs to 500,000 POSs in 2 years. Now somebody will ask, who the hell is going to pay for them? The traders are not going to pay. We will pay. FBR will pay. We are going to pay for the POSs, and then we'll come up with a scheme whereby we give prizes to people who actually pay the sales tax. They send us the invoices or receipts, and we'll give them prizes every month. Large prizes, a very large pool of prizes. So the consumer is going to make sure they force the retailer to give the proper receipt, or they'll move away from that store. So it's not going to be coercion. We are going to incentivize the customer to do that. And this has happened not only what we are doing, this is not unique. This happened in Turkey, happened in Colombia. I saw, in Kenya, there have been numbers in almost all retail shops. So it's happening all over the world. So this will help us really increase our sales, where we have 17% sales, GST. But the contribution is, less than 5%, We're also going to, incentivize the productive sectors, the industry, the exports, as I said, told you, agriculture. This time around, I just told the Ministry of Commerce, you tell us what's the envelope you need, and let us not tell you how to distribute that. You distribute to those industries, those exporters, who will enhance the productivity in their sectors. So they are going to be the decision makers. It's a paradigm shift. And let me tell you, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, nobody wants to let go of it, the control. And FBR is no exception. But I have convinced them, and they are convinced now, they let the productive side of our economy tell us what they need, and then we'll track it. It's not that, we just basically is free money. But we'll track it, but they have to decide. And this is, as I said, is a paradigm shift in thinking. We are going to incentivize exports through SCZs. As a matter of fact, we just decided that 1.5% in turnover tax is not going to be applicable in special economic zones. We are going to incentivize exports in the value-added sector. And we are going to incentivize IT. IT is $2 billion exports this year. I want to see that $8 billion in 2023. And by the way, in India, they broke the $1 billion exports in 2000. By 2010, they had crossed $100 billion. We had the same, a kind of caliber of people, if not better. So I think IT is where we must invest. And then we need to bring in FDI. This is very important. We need to bring in FDI in the export sector. Well, fortunately, unfortunately, and I'm not blaming the private sector in this, but somehow the other, we have been saying export or import substitution is the same thing. I don't think so. When you basically say import substitution, yes, you replace, you know, what you, the dollars you would have spent on imports. Exports gives you much more than that. Export gives you, you see, the ability to, if you have FDI over there, the technology, the money which comes in, the foreign currency for investments, but export markets. And that's how these East Asian countries, including China, have progressed. You all realize what Deng Xiaoping did in 1979. He actually created four zones and told them that these are your zones. You will have your own, you know, legal system, financial system, you know, labor system, and ability to train people, and we'll give you the territory, and then, you know, you just bring in money, manufacture and re-export. Malaysia did the same thing. India has done, you know, more or less the same thing. Turkey has done it, and so we should do the same thing. We must now encourage FDI in exports. We also need to, because exports have been a family business, so what has happened is the father is the chairman, the eldest son is the managing director, and then finance director and sales director. So when father dies, within two generations, the family splits, and so does the business. All our industries today are fragmented, whether it's textile, whether it is leather, sports goods, you know. I think, you know, just there are exceptions, large groups over there. Otherwise, it's fragmented. So they cannot compete with the rest of the world. So they become a commodity business and they basically compete on price. So we got to consolidate this. Unfortunately, we did not have a Chapter 11. Now we have that in shape of CRA, Corporate Restructuring Act. So we use that, we create the enabling environment and consolidate our industry. So there is scale, so there is value addition, and we bring in foreign investors to buy those entities and invest. We got to develop the most important, you know, asset we have, human resource. I think Hamayun mentioned that. I mean, our, you know, education level at 60% is not good enough. Our health, we don't spend any money over there. I think Prime Minister Imran Khan wants to quadruple, you know, the investments into these two categories. Obviously, these are the provincial subjects, but we'll work with the provinces to make sure that we basically spend quality money on education and health. There is another area which people forget, but it's a great enabler. I think Hamayun has already mentioned that, and that's the financial sector. I think banking footprint, you know, is only 33-34% of the GDP. Compare that to 50-55% in Bangladesh, 80-90% in India, 180% in Korea, and 225% in China. So if our entire formal economy, which has no access to capital markets, depends on the banking sector, and banking sector only supports them, you know, 16-17%, because the advances to deposit ratio is only 50%, then how the hell are we going to grow? So we have to work on that. We have to increase the banking footprint in this country. We have to, you know, remove the regional disparity in the resource allocations. Money is collected all over the country, spent in only 85% of that is spent in nine cities. KPK has over 600 billions of deposits. They, you know, money lent in KPK is less than 50 billion rupees. Similarly, Balochistan, North Sindh, South Punjab, Azad Kashmir. So this disparity has to be removed. The sectoral, 75% is corporate, you know, lending. The rest is 5-6% here and there, you know, whether it's SME, consumer, agriculture. So I think this has to be removed. Then create capacity, as Humayun said, to fund projects and infrastructure. When PICC, IDPP, etc. were rolled, you know, into different banks and said that, well, we have large banks and they are going to lend projects and for projects and infrastructure, that hasn't happened. Because they have gone to the private sector, and the private sector, you know, finds very, very easy to make money by putting money into the government paper. So we got to say now set up, you know, some, you know, DFIs and infrastructure development, you know, banks. We have to bring in FDI. Board of Investment has to do a better job. We have to now leverage CPAC. China is outsourcing 85 million jobs in the sunset industry, but for us, that's not sunset, textile, leather, and all, and including, we should ask them to bring in, you know, investment in IT. We would like to bring in technology in all facets of our economic life. So make the economy more efficient. I think I'll just stop right here. So at the end, what am I saying? There will be emphasis on growth. And we would like to have it all inclusive and sustainable growth. I don't want to see this economy, you know, just going through the 10% in 2 years. It will not. And it should not. We should grow the economy in a manner whereby it sustains itself over a long period of time and it's inclusive. So thank you, gentlemen. I'm here to take your calls, questions.
وفاقی وزیر خزانہ شوکت ترین بجٹ ویبینار سے خطاب کر رہے تھے. انہوں نے کہا کہ جب حکومت سنبھالی تو ملک کو معیشت کی شدید بحران کا سامنا تھا. وزیراعظم عمران خان نے معیشت کی بحالی کے لیے بڑے فیصلے کیے, روپے کی قدر میں اضافے کے لیے ترجیحی اقدامات کیے گئے اور اب ہماری معیشت بہتری کی جانب گامزن ہے.